We want our young people and some of our elderly people to take part and know what it's all about. So, without further ado, thank you, Father, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're going to bring before you right now Mr. Albert. Just give him a hand.
All right.
But I was born and raised right up in the heart of the city. Went to elementary school at 8th and T, Cleveland, Grimke on Grumman Avenue, Shore Junior High, Brown Junior High, and then to Armstrong where I graduated in 46. But as growing up, we knew our place. We knew places we could go and places you couldn't. Our theater, we could go. But down at the Capitol on F Street, when the big bands come, you could not go. Most of you, if you've been around here, know the restaurant that was at 13th and F Street that would always have them cherry strawberry cakes. Oh, as a kid, we would like to go in there. We couldn't go. But you was accepted it. We could ride the buses and streetcars. As kids on Sunday, we used to ride the streetcars three on a pass.
Yeah. Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah.
So this particular Sunday, I have a brother that was 3 years older, my sister 2 years younger than me. We wanted to go to Glen Echo. So we caught the pass, rode all the way out Wisconsin Avenue. When we got to Glen Echo, they stopped the streetcar and told us, we have to go around, go across the track. You can't go in there. That's when I really began to know what it is to be a black youth. And today when they said, talk about Glen Echo, I don't want to go. I wanted to go when I was a kid. But I survived, and we all survived. 1950, Korean War broke out. On the 25th of June, on the 29th of June, I got engaged. But I knew this wasn't going to last long because I was prime meat for Uncle Sam. And sure enough, about 2 weeks later, here come my wonderful greeting from my uncle. And being a true American, I answered the call, inducted. But the thing about it, when you go into the service and I want Mr. Johnson to sit back there and think about this, they ask you to take one step forward, raise your right hand, and you repeat what the president and everyone else, that you would defend this country. You lay down your life for it.
Yeah.
But as a black man, you was treated secondhand. I went in. Fortunate enough, I missed going over to Korea. I did 19 months on the Russian border. That's when everybody was worried about whether Russia was going to start World War III. And while there, it was quite an experience. I'll bring you back to that. Somewhere in 2012, I got a letter from Congresswoman Donna Edwards. And they sent me a letter. Would you participate in recollection of your memories? So many of World War II veterans had passed. So many of the Korean War veterans had passed. Will you share your memories and your experiences? And I said, yeah. I don't know how they got my name. I went to a few seminars. I went to a University of PG County, and there I sat down and recollected my experience. Or the lady I talked to was a white lady. She has her PhD in African American history. And she said, yes, I know all about your struggles. And she said, come on, just open up to me. And when I went on and told her about growing up and coming into service, and I told her, when we went in, Mr. Johnson, we were colored. I went into an all-segregated outfit. Remember one thing, on the battlefield, those bullets are not marked, white or black. So I went in to this all-black outfit. But President Truman had signed, there's no more segregated army. And they never implemented it until about January, February, 52. That's when they started. And that's when I was sent, seven of us from this black company was sent down to this white company. And let me tell you, it's a difference. It's the difference between chalk and cheese. The way they ate, the way they soldiered, everything they got, it was different. You get pass me down clothes, they get new clothes. Well, that was a short time, and I went on. But fortunate enough, my schooling had allowed me, they gave me a little bit of education. And every time they had a class to come up, I was able to go. We were receiving these brand new tanks. And most of the men know that the United States don't give nothing away. And in the service, everything got to be spit and polished. I had this little detail. To clean this tank. And I had a little right. I had five white soldiers. And I gave them an order. I said, look, let's clean these tanks. I'll go by, get some sandwiches from the mess sergeant. Okay, Sergeant Dickson, all right. Four of them jumped up on the tank. One guy stood there. I said, so-and-so, where I come from, we don't do nothing. A nigga tell us what to do. That was said to me. This little PFC wasn't nothing but breath and riches. If I'd have hit him, I'd have probably killed him. But my parents didn't raise no fool.
Yeah.
If I'd have hit him, they would have charged me. And in the meantime, all the white soldiers, sergeants stood around. They never once came to my aid. This guy disobeyed a non-commissioned officer. I gave him a direct order. He still refused. I went to the company commander, the first sergeant, to send for him, and they brought him in. He refused again. This is one time when I can say the pen was mightier than the sword. He was given 6 months hard labor, forfeit of all benefits, and 6 months of bad time you got to make up. And I want to share this with you. My oldest brother was my idol. I never once called, I never once wrote him, told him when I came home. I never shared this story until 2013 because I felt as though I let this young boy call me that and I didn't do nothing about it. But I kept it to myself until that day when I told that story. And the lady said to me, she said, how do you feel now? I said, well, experience is a great learning experience. So I said, I've come on. So they had this ceremony over at Andrews. And all of our stories, they passed over to the Library of Congress archives. And my story will live in infamy, right down there with Martin Luther King, the presidents. It'll be there forever.
Yeah.
I've come a long way, and I've learned, keep your nose clean, as most of us knew. The Army was great. And like a fool, I was drafted for 2 years. I ended up doing 10. But I will say this, it made a man of me.
Yeah.
And I treasure those 10 years I put into service. And I've learned to accept white and black. But it's a bad thing for a black man to be asked to give his life for his country.
Yeah.
And his country treat him as second class.
Yeah.
A lot of places I went before the civil rights movement was turned down. But that's all right. I've learned to go back to those places. And now I can walk in and be waited on and served. And I'm proud to this day that I am a black man in the United States of America.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Take 2 eyes to make a pair.
and rockin'.